One sat alone beside the highway, begging. His eyes were blind, the light he could not see. He clutched his old rags and shivered in the shadows. Then Jesus came and bade his darkness flee. When Jesus comes.
It's time again for the Family Altar program with Evangelist Lester Roloff.
When Jesus comes, all the tears are dried away.
And here now is Brother Roloff.
And fills the life with glory. For all is changed when Jesus comes to stay.
First gospel in the New Testament, and we're going to stop at the instruction time where Jesus was teaching his disciples what a Christian ought to do. Now that's the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5, 6, and 7. If you'd like a real challenge, memorize these three chapters. It's the greatest sermon ever preached to Christians. Nobody's ever compared with this preaching. No preacher's ever given such heavenly instruction. And Jesus is not, this is not the plan of salvation. This is instruction. This is his foundation. He's running for king, and he'll be king some of these days. He ought to be king now in our own heart, but he'll be the king of the world. He'll be the king of all civilization, and he'll reign and rule, and it'll be permanent. Until he does, there'll be war, there'll be sin, there'll be broken homes, there'll be trouble, and there'll be upheavals, there'll be violence that'll cover the face of the earth. And there'll be every kind of disturbance that you can think of, because we're not in God's order. We're not in God's order. And when we get in God's order, we'll have God's blessing. When we get in on Bible ground, we'll have Bible blessings. And so, I want you to turn with me to the seventh chapter. The seventh chapter. I want to talk with you about the average person's favorite pastime for a little bit. What does he do? A lot of people say, well, I do that from a pastime. One president, I remember, that I could not endorse, said that he drank bourbon liquor and played poker for pastime. If he's a Christian, he would have played for his last time. It'd be over. Christians don't do that. I said Christians just do not do it. He claimed to be a Christian and a Baptist, but far as I'm concerned, he was wicked and rotten, and his tongue was dirty and filthy. And so, you see, by their fruits you'll know them. It'll make any difference what they may claim or profess, it's what they possess and practice. And anybody that can't practice the gospel evidently has not really known what the gospel means. And so, we not only teach the boys and girls and men and women that come our way that we are to be saved, but we're to live like it. We're to demonstrate it. We need some demonstrators today. And so I gathered some things by way of illustration that I want to share with you, but let me read the scripture first, please. Beginning at chapter 7, verse 1, judge not that you be not judged. For with what judgments you judge, you shall be judged. And with what measure you meet, it'll be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Now my thought when I read that a moment ago was this. Don't try to be an optometrist till you get your own eyes fixed. I mean, don't set up an office and say, optometrist, and come in until you make sure you got some eyes where you can see what's wrong with somebody else's. Now, the average person has a pastime of judging others and wanting to fix other people's eyes. And he said, I don't want you now trying to get a mote. Now, you know, a mote's a very small thing. A mote's a very small thing. He said, now, why beholdest thou the mote that's in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam? You know what a beam is? What he's saying is this, and of course he enlarges on it, it's kind of an extreme illustration, but he said, why in the world do you think you've got to go around and get a little mote out of somebody else's eye and you got a beam hanging in yours? I mean, you're dragging a beam around with yours, huh? Well, I mean, that's something, isn't it? And yet, Doesn't that cause us trouble? You know, the greatest sin among Christians is self-righteousness and pride. Why, sometimes the very fact of your progress and your growth will ruin you because you'll give yourself the credit and say, well, I believe I've done better than the rest of them. No, God did better. And you're going to do worse anytime you take the credit for what God has done. And that's going to ruin you. That's good. The very blessings of God has ruined a lot of preachers. Now, the goodness of God leadeth men to repentance, but sometimes the goodness of God leadeth men to pride and arrogance and a haughty spirit and then a downfall. A downfall. It seems to me, now the Bible says, the wise man said in the book of Proverbs, he said, the blessing of the Lord maketh rich and he hath no sorrow with it. Doesn't add a bit of sorrow with it. But the blessings of the devil comes with a lot of sorrow. A lot of sorrow and a lot of curses come with it. Don't be pulling a little mote out of somebody's eye till you got the beam out of your own eye. Or how will thou say to thy brother? Now look at that. Brother? Sure. Because, you see, you know if he wasn't a brother, he'd be blind. Wouldn't just have a mote or a beam, he'd be blind. See? But he said, how can you say to thy brother? Thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye. You hypocrite. That's what he said, wasn't it? Thou hypocrite. First, cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet, and turn again, and rend you. Now here's your promise. This puts us in the promised land. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, ye shall find. Knock, it shall be opened unto you. Did you notice those three verbs? Did you notice those three verbs? Did he said, ask, you'll get it. Seek, you'll find it. Knock, it'll be open. Every time, he said, you'll get a response. You'll get a response. A lot of doors I can knock on wouldn't get in. I'm sure of that. And there are a lot of doors I never would get to because they'd stop before I got there. I mean, I imagine I could sort of land in Washington, you know, and they'd say, well, who you plan to see? I said, the president. Did you know you're coming? Oh, no, it don't make any difference. I mean, I'll just happen up, you know. I'll just tell him I just happened to drop in on him. Yeah. Well, I tell you what, I'd never drop very far, would I? I said, you don't know who I am? I said, why, I'm Brother Roloff. They said, never heard of you. Never heard of you. And they said, listen, Brother Roloff, you need to understand that there's nuts by the thousands that come by here won't see the president. They can't see him. I mean, he hadn't got time to fool you. I said, can you, you know, and I could say, you don't mean it, huh? Yes, sir. They said, oh, yeah, we do mean it, too. Said, beat it. Beat it, huh? That's right. But listen, thank God. I can just go up and come on in. Been waiting for you. Yeah. Well, are the Pashas coming in, waving at me, see? Yes, sir. Come on in. All right. He said, ask and it shall be given. Seek, you shall find. Knock, it shall be opened. For everyone that asketh, receive it. How many of them? How many of them receive? Come on. All right, all of them. Talk back to me. How many of them receive? Now then, looks to me like anybody want to call if you're going to. He said, everyone that asks. Everybody that called said he got an answer. Everyone that asks, receiveth. He that seeketh, findeth. To him that knocketh, it shall be open. I got a blessing out of those alls. A-double-L, all. All your troubles, all your fears. I mean, all of them, gone. Every one of them, gone. I tell you, you see, if he'd have said most of them, I said, well, he'll probably leave the worst of them I got. Huh? No, he said all of them. Praise the Lord. I lost every one of them. Or what man is there of you whom if his son asks bread, will he give him a stone? Can you imagine that? Here's the picture. There's a little old boy and his dad walking along. The little old boy looks up at him. Oh, he's hungry. Man, I tell you the truth, he's hungry. They've been walking long ways. Been walking long ways. And you know, the mother made some great, big, beautiful hot rolls before they left, and he just got a great big sack of them, you know, and some honey right out of the big gum. Yes. He's walking along, and there's honey and the honeycomb, and there's some big, beautiful rolls. And the little boy said, Daddy, He said, yes, son. He said, we walked a long ways, haven't we? He said, yes, we have. He said, we got up early, didn't we, Dad? And he said, yes, we did, son. He said, I'm really hungry. You, Dad? And he said, yeah, I'm a little hungry. He said, you really hungry, son? Oh, yes, I'm starving, Dad. He said, I'm even getting weak. He said, I'll tell you, how much more we got to walk? He said, could you give me a piece of bread? Dad reached down by the side road, picks up rock, pitched it, and said, no, not rock. Little boy said, Daddy, it doesn't bite well. I mean, that... Can you imagine a little old boy throwing a rock in his mouth, walking along, said, Daddy, I'm still hungry. I've been unable to bite this rock, huh? What'd he say? A little boy gets hungry, said, Daddy, would you give me a big hot biscuit or a big piece of light bread or a big piece of whole wheat that Mother made, and would you just give me some? He said, son, get that rock down and eat it. Forget about bread. Now, he's talking about the Heavenly Father. Are you listening? If he asks a fish, will he give him a serpent? Can you imagine that? Walks on down the road and comes to a fish market. Maybe a big fish fry. Somebody said, be glad to help yourself to fish. Little boy said, Daddy. He said, could I have a piece of that hot red fish? Oh, listen, look at that great big baked trout in there. Daddy, could I just go? He told me I could come. Could I go? He just reached down in the weeds and pulls out a little old snake. Said, here, eat that snake. Chew on that old snake! Can you imagine that? That daddy's pretty bad, isn't he? I don't believe I'd want a dad like that, would you? Give me a stone for a biscuit. Give me a snake for a piece of fish. No, sir. Now, wait a minute. He said, if ye then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more, that's a great text, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? Every good thing's come from the Lord. Therefore, now then, this will solve every problem we got in our homes. This is for Christians now. Therefore, all things, whatsoever you would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Now then, listen to me for just a moment. The golden rule is we'll never get you to heaven. And I tell you what, you'd say, Brother Olaf, now wait a minute. Don't you believe if I really kept the golden rule that I'd go to heaven? And I'm going to reverse myself and contradict myself and say, yes, I believe you could. But I know of no lost person that can keep the golden rule, and you don't either. Because a golden rule is precipitated by the fact that we're to be Christian enough to love somebody else more than we love ourselves. And I don't believe a lost person will ever do that. I never did love people. I mean, I never did love other people like I love them now until Jesus came in and shed and brought his love by the Holy Spirit. And dear friends, you're not going to fool yourself or anybody else. You do not love other people genuinely and with the right kind of love unless you have Jesus Christ in your heart. And so he said, whatsoever you would that men do to you, do you also to them. This is the law and the prophets. This is, now, this is the first book of the Bible. I mean, the New Testament. And he said, this is the law and the prophets. Well, brother, if that's the law and the prophets, what do you think grace ought to bring about? What do you think God's people ought to be that are born again, have the Spirit of God, been saved with the blood of Jesus Christ, have the entire Bible? What in the world do you think we ought to be like? We ought to have us a new golden rule. We ought to have a bigger golden rule. We ought to be living by the enlarged golden rule, the royal love, the law of love. And so God's people today ought to just be so different. All right, let's read on. Enter ye in at the gate. Come in at the gate, he said. What kind of gate? Straight gate. Enter ye in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be, that go in thereat. I'm sorry about that. I tell you, I wish that was not so, but it is so. It is so. Enter ye in the straight gate. Wide is the gate. Broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. How many finds it? Many. That's how many people are going to go to hell. Many. Whether you like it or don't like it, and I don't like it, but I'm not going to preach it any other way because that's true. Listen, most people in the Rio Grande Valley will go to hell when they die. According to the Bible, they will. Most people are lost in the Rio Grande Valley. And most people act like they're lost. No spiritual love, no concern, nothing but a bunch of selfishness, pleasure loving, liquor drinking, cigarette smoking, television watching. They don't even act like Christians. Not even fooling themselves. And Jesus said, since it's so, I'll put it down like it is. Many there be that's going to go in thereat. But there's another picture. Because straight is the gate. Straight is the gate. Narrow is the way which leadeth unto life. And few there be that find it. Now sometimes new Christians would say, Brother Wolf, why is the way so narrow? And why is the gate so straight? Well, you said, did you make it like that? No, I just preach it like I read it like that in the Bible. But listen, I got good news for you. There's room enough in the narrow road for a number of things. Number one, I can walk arm in arm with Jesus without getting in the ditch. Or having a head-on collision with something that'll wreck my car, see? I mean, the narrow road is... Now, hear me now, real good. I've never said this like this before, but this is the truth. The narrow road is wide enough to get everybody to heaven without having a wreck if you stay in it. Praise God for that. Now you people say, oh, well, you know, that narrow-minded. That's right, the way's narrow. I don't have any patience. I don't have any time to put up with these broad-minded people that intend to fit everybody's mold. Wouldn't give you a dime for a cow pasture full of them. They're not worth killing. You show me these preachers. You show me these preachers, they can just play on anybody's team. And as old Dr. Ray used to say, he's a sorry dog that'll trot on anybody's wagon. Huh? Well, I tell you, I've had dogs that trot on no wagon but mine. I've had bird dogs that hunt for nobody except me. I mean, and they'd bring their birds to nobody but me. One way to get more birds. You'd say, reckon why they were trained like that. They recognized the authority of the master. They'd pass up a half a dozen hunters looking for the master when they had a bird in their mouth. Brother, we're to bring our birds home to God. He's our master. We're not to be dropping our birds in ever old hunter's hands. Those bird dogs of mine had a conviction that I shot the bird anyhow. They had that much confidence in me, see. They'd been out with me many times. They said, he's the one that feeds me. He's the one that doctors my bleeding feet when we get home. He's the one that gets those old sorry ticks off of me. He's the one that defleas me. He's the one that's taken me upstairs, laid me down and picked those old prickly pear out of me many a night after I'd run hard all day long. Yeah, I'll go to my master with my produce. Amen? A wonderful thing if we'd have as much sense as a dog, wouldn't it, sometime? Lord, have mercy to help us to know who the master is. He said, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life. And what? What's that next word? What's that next word? Few there be that find it. I'm sorry about that, but that's so. Isn't it pathetic that Jesus could save everybody and yet very few will ever be saved? The Bible says very few. Oh, I know we got a lot of these lenient, compromising, Casper milk toasts that say, well, we believe the Lord's going to be very lenient. We believe the Lord is going to overlook a lot of things, and we believe that He'll let just about everybody in. He's a loving Heavenly Father. My Bible says few. F-E-W, few. Oh, you'd say, Brother Wolf, it's a dismal picture. No, but I got the bright side to present to you. You could be one of those few if you wanted to be. Now, beware false prophets. Watch out, he said. Beware bad dog. Mean dog. I've seen no signs. I don't argue with that sign. I never do. I said, well, it's just kidding me. No, it's not. Well, I tell you, I had a dog one day. He ran at me, and I tell you, he ripped my britches leg from the knee down. And I didn't regret that. He just missed my calf of my leg a little, see? But oh, listen. He said, I know something is worse. Because the Bible says over there, you know, he said, beware of dogs. Beware of dogs. Beware of the of evil workers. Beware of the concision, for we're the circumcision, see? Which worship God in the spirit and have no confidence in the flesh. Not a bit. not a bit. All right? Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. You see? Now, if something were to come to you, you look up and say, oh, listen, isn't that a beautiful sheep coming across there? Just look at that wool on that sheep. Oh, listen, I'm going to go out and pet that old sheep. They're gentle. You know, sheep are humble animals. They really are. And I'm going to go out, and boy, listen, all of a sudden you start petting that thing on the head. And them old teeth about that long. Man, he don't have no teeth. Like, see, if teeth has, a sheep has the molars and teeth like ours, you see. See, our teeth are not even made to chew meat. Did you know that? See, that the animals, see, they have those old long teeth. Boy, they punch holes through it, you see. I mean, they tear it. See, they can tear it. But our teeth are like sheep's teeth. And so, you see, we were made to eat the vegetables and things like that. Say what you please. That's what God intended. I mean, he made us like that, you see. Of course, man won't pay attention to it. But, I mean, you go out there and you say, oh, listen, he chewed my arm off of me. Uh-huh. He tore my muscles out. That's right. You'd say, well, I didn't recognize him. He had on sheep's clothing. See? And he's dressed in wool. That's right. Now, wait a minute. We got to figure out. Now, God's talking about sinners. He's talking about prophets. He's talking about preachers. He's talking about people climbing up the bush. How can you tell one? I mean, I'd sure like to be able to recognize a wolf, see, before he tore me up and before he bit me. I'm going to show you what he does. But you shall know them by their fruits. You'll know them by their fruits. Mm-hmm. Do men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles or oranges off of mesquite trees? No, sir. No, sir. Do they get big, nice, pink grapefruit off of thorn trees? No, sir. They do not. All right, let's read on. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. And if you're not bringing forth good fruit, you're not a good tree. He said every. How many of them? Every. Every. How many is that? That's all of them, isn't it? That means every good tree is going to bring forth good fruit. Good fruit.
We are delighted that you joined us today for the Family Altar program with Evangelist Lester Roloff and the message, One of the Few. If you would like to receive this message on a CD, simply ask for offer number RO3226 and include $10 to help cover shipping and handling, and we would like to have today's date. The address is the Roloff Evangelistic Enterprises, Post Office Box 1177, Corpus Christi, Texas 78403. And to use your credit card, dial toll-free at 1-800-772-7507. God's Little Biscuit is an intriguing title for the special offer this month. God's Little Biscuit is a message by Brother Roloff illustrating God as he takes weak, humble, and sometimes fearful people and uses them for wonderful things. Now, Brother Roloff has taken the text from Judges 6 and 7. That's the way he builds the message. We're requesting the CD for $10, and you just simply ask for offer number RO1395 and include $10 to help with shipping and handling. And if you'd like to use your credit card, dial toll-free 1-800-772-7507, or you can write us at the Roloff Evangelistic Enterprises, Post Office Box 1177, Corpus Christi, Texas 78403. Again, the offer is God's Little Biscuit. The offer number is 1395. Include $10 for shipping and handling. And the address is the Roloff Evangelistic Enterprises, Post Office Box 1177, Corpus Christi, Texas 78403. Now, as you realize, we're in the summer months now, and that's when the giving usually is really off quite a bit. So we really need your help right now, so I hope that you'll include more than just the CD. The address again is the Roloff Evangelistic Enterprises, Post Office Box 1177, Corpus Christi, Texas 78403. And to use your credit card, dial toll-free 1-800-772-7507. This is Gene Price speaking for the staff, and we're looking forward to being with you again here on the Family Altar program.
The strangers to God, His grace and His love, were gathered by Blue
Galilee, to listen with joy to words from the lips of the stranger who sat by the sea. They came and they were blessed. He gave the weary rest. He made the blinded eyes to see. He fed the hungry soul, and he made the wounded whole by the waters of blue Galilee. They sat at his feet and they looked in his face, content in his presence to be, for no one before had cared for their souls like the stranger who sat by the sea. They came and they were blessed. He gave the weary rest. He made the blinded eyes to see. He fed the hungry soul, and he made the wounded whole by the waters of blue Galilee. They came and they were blessed. He gave the weary rest. He made the blinded eyes to see. He fed the hungry soul, and he made the wounded whole by the waters of blue Galilee.